This episode of Trailblazer Weekly coming to you live from the CEC TV studios. I'm your host, Keric Seegmiller. Today, we'll recap the latest basketball, softball, baseball, and golf results, as well as take a look at January's top five plays. We'll also hear from softball head coach Randy Simkins. So as you can see, it's another loaded show today. Let's not waste any time. Let's get this thing started. Trailblazer Weekly starts now. Well, it may be hard to believe, but yes, spring sports are upon us. Both baseball and softball opened their seasons last week, and today we start the show with softball. The Trailblazers opened the 2017 season on Thursday, hosting Northwest Nazarene in a doubleheader at Carl Brooks Field. Trailblazers wasted no time building a lead in game one, scoring 6 runs on 7 hits in the first inning. That set the tone as Dixie State cruised to an 11-1 win in that game. Danny Barthoff led the way offensively with 4 RBIs as she crushed a grand slam down the left field line in the fourth inning. Brooklyn Beardshire picked up the win in the pitcher's circle, giving up 1 run on 5 hits with 4 strikeouts in 4 innings of work. Dixie State picked up where it left off in game two, using home runs by Jessica Gonzalez and Josie Hartman in the first inning to set the tone for an 8-2 victory to clinch the doubleheader sweep over the Crusaders. Alexandria Melendez earned the victory in the pitcher's circle, allowing 1 run on 3 hits with 3 strikeouts, while Alexis Barkwell threw the final 3 innings of the game to earn the save. Trailblazers used that momentum to help earn another doubleheader sweep, this time over Montana State Billings on Monday, that was yesterday, at Carl Brooks Field. Arista Honey belted a grand slam in the first inning as Dixie State claimed an 8-2 victory in game one, with Brooklyn Beardshire picking up her 2nd win of the season. Dixie State trailed 5-1 in game two, but an 11-run third inning, capped by a Bailey Gaffin grand slam, helped clinch the doubleheader sweep with a 13-5 win. Alexis Barkwell earned the win, giving up 1 hit and striking out 2 2⅓ inning of work. So Dixie State, the softball team, 4-0 start, good start there. A lot of games left this week. We'll tell you about those a little bit later in the show. To baseball now, as Dixie State opened its season with a 4-game series at Cal State San Bernardino last week. The Trailblazers earned the 4-game sweep over the Coyotes, picking up a 9-6 win on Friday, then winning 13-6 and 5-4 in the doubleheader on Saturday, and closing the series with a 10-1 win on Sunday. Dixie State senior infielder Tyler Mildenberg was named PacWest Player of the Week for his efforts in helping lead the Trailblazers to the sweep. Mildenberg started in 3 of the 4 games and batted .556 with 3 extra base hits, 4 RBIs, and 5 runs scored. He collected at least 1 base hit in all 3 starts, including a 3-for-3 effort with 2 home runs, 1 double, 3 RBIs, and 3 runs scored in game 3 Saturday afternoon. Mildenberg also had a hit and a run scored in the opener on Friday, and also connected for an RBI hit with a run scored in Sunday's finale. So again, like the softball team, big congrats to the baseball team and a great season opening series, starting the season 4-0, and then Mildenberg getting named the PacWest Player of the Week for his efforts. To the golf course now, as we check in on the women's golf team in San Diego. Dixie State finds itself in 7th place after the first round of play at the Point Loma hosted Reach 2017 tournament on Monday. Sophomore Katie Ford co-led the field with a 4-over par 76 to finish day one in a two-way tie for 5th place individually, while junior Colbert Collinsworth fired a 7-over 79 to stand in a 6-way tie for 16th place overall. Of course, the Trailblazers in progress right now in San Diego with day 2 of that tournament, wrapping up their time at Point Loma today. It's time now for our first break. When we come back, we'll recap last week's basketball results with highlights from the Chaminade game. It's all coming up right after this timeout on Trailblazer Weekly.
I'll never forget the day our landlord called and said, "Read your lease. No pets allowed." My owner tells him my dog ate the lease, but that didn't work. And now I'm stuck in a shelter, but this pit bull is ready for a new crib. I'm loving, loyal, and play well with others. So don't be intimidated by all my muscles, because the biggest one I have is my heart. That's right, I said it.
There is a place where rocks bleed and nature blushes on a battlefield green with envy. Where dimples determine destiny and a tiny wooden teeth holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where friends are opponents and opponents are friends. where the prize is elusive, the conquest is captivating, and the score isn't settled till the drinks are down. There is a place.
I'm Anne. I'm a scientist.
Recycling takes a team.
Why don't you let me
and me help you out?
Everyone plays a part. Don't trash.
I love taking stuff apart and building new things out of it.
What could be treasure?
Pal's my most advanced Android.
This is awesome.
You haven't seen anything yet.
Give your cardboard box another life. Recycle.
So, I'm kind of new here, but I've noticed a trend. My human does this funny thing where she goes around and gets all my toys, and then she hides them in that basket by the door. You know, but it's always the same basket, and it's always in the same place. And then she acts so surprised when I find them, but, you know, she's putting them in the same basket. Again. It's like, hello? That's where you put it last time. You were the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
Welcome back inside the CEC TV studios and inside Trailblazer Weekly. We're going to continue our look back with women's basketball. The Trailblazers opened the week on Thursday hosting BYU Hawaii with an opportunity to snap a five-game losing skid, and Dixie State did just that. Behind a double-double, 15 points and 10 rebounds, the Trailblazers led almost wire to wire for the 67-61 win over the Seasiders in that BYU Hawaii's final trip to the Burns Arena. Up next for the women's team was Chaminade and a chance for the first back-to-back wins of the season for the Trailblazers. And they were able to do that as well. Let's show you how it happened. We've got the highlights for you right here on Trailblazer Weekly. It was Allie Franks getting things started with the rebound and the putback. Franks would finish with 15 points and 8 rebounds, a game-high mark in that game. Tremina Jordan later knocking down a three. Her teammates loving that one. And then she gets another chance a few minutes later, knocks it down from the right wing. Jordan would finish with 8 points with those two threes. Lisa Van Campa not only had herself a good game, you see her get the steal there, but she had a great week. 10 boards on the week, on the game for her. She would be named the defender of the week in the PacWest. We'll tell you more about that in just a minute. Gabby Cabanero, you saw a layup from her and then knocking down the three straight away. Maddie Ventling a three also, and Shelby Kasuba getting in on the scoring action in the second half. This game would go to overtime, but Maddie Ventling says, no big deal, I'll knock down another three. Ventling finished with a double-double, 10 points, 10 rebounds as Dixie State holds on for the 76-74 win in overtime, earning consecutive wins for the first time this season. Lisa Van Campen was named PacWest Defender of the Week for her efforts in the wins. Van Campen averaged 6.5 points and 10.5 rebounds per game, 15 of her 21 rebounds coming on the defensive side. So again, congratulations to the women's basketball team. First back-to-back wins of the season, and big shout-out to Lisa Van Campen, PacWest Defender of the Week. To men's basketball now, as the Trailblazer men look to build on a three-game win streak with BYU Hawaii coming to the Burns Arena for the final time on Thursday. The Trailblazers turned a 7-point halftime deficit into an 88-74 win on Thursday, outscoring the Seasiders 54-33 in the second half. Marcus Bradley led the way with a career-high 23 points and 15 rebounds in the win over the Seasiders. Then it was time for Chaminade to come to town, looking to burst Dixie State's bubble in the four-game win streak. But it was the fourth of a four-game trip for the Silver Swords as Dixie State blew the door open, wide open for their fifth consecutive victory, this one over the Silver Swords. Let's run the tape on that one as well. If you take a look at the highlights, Brandon Simister getting things started like he does a lot, knocking down the J. It wasn't a three, but a deep two. Austin Montgomery, he finished with 8 points in the game, a lot of those coming in the first half. And Marcus Bradley, let's be honest, we're getting used to this. His scoring threat is Marcus Bradley, 16 points on the day for him. We're already used to Trevor Hill scoring from just about anywhere on the floor. You can't give him that much room. He'll knock down the three. Trevor would go on to score this scoop and score in the lane as well. 14 points for Trevor on the night. Daylor Youngblood, though, the play of the day, the steal, and the bank is open. Banking in the three as time expired in the first half. We'll see more from him later. Zach Hunter, the one-hand jam in the paint in the second half, followed by Kyler Nielsen. But as promised, back to Daylor, the layup in transition for Daylor, and then the three ball straight away. He would hit three triples in this game, that one there, and then the final one from the right corner to get Dixie State over the century mark as the Trailblazers winning it 102 to 66 as Youngblood finished with a new career high of 12 points and 4 rebounds. Zach Hunter also setting a new career high with 19 points. With that, we'll take our next break. When we come back, we're joined by softball head coach Randy Simkins. We're going to preview the 2017 season and take a look at the 2017 roster, let you know who's back and who you should look out for this season. Don't go anywhere. There's more Trailblazer Weekly after this timeout.
There is a place where rocks bleed and nature blushes on a battlefield green with envy, where dimples determine destiny and a tiny wooden tee holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where friends are opponents and opponents are friends, where the prize is elusive, the conquest is captivating, and the score isn't settled till the drinks are down. There is a place.
Your daughter is having trouble learning French. Do you A, hire a tutor?
Bonjour.
B, enforce a French-only rule at home? Or C, watch some foreign films? When it comes to parenting, there are no perfect answers. But that's okay, because you don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Teens in foster care will love you just the same.
I'll never forget the day our landlord called and said, read your lease. No pets allowed. My owner tells him my dog ate the lease, but that didn't work. And now I'm stuck in a shelter. But this pit bull is ready for a new crib. I'm loving, loyal, and play well with others. So don't be intimidated by all my muscles, because the biggest one I have is my heart. That's right, I said it.
There is a place where rocks bleed and nature blushes on a battlefield green with envy, where dimples determine destiny and a tiny wooden tee holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where friends are opponents and opponents are friends, where the prize is elusive, the conquest is captivating, and the score isn't settled till the drinks are down. There is a place.
Welcome back inside Trailblazer Weekly. As I mentioned earlier, it's hard to believe that the spring sports season is underway, but indeed it is upon us, and today we're pleased to have softball head coach Randy Simkins joining us on the show. Randy, I know it's a busy time of the year for you like everybody else. Thanks for stopping by, spending some time with us.
Great to be here. No place I'd rather be.
The 2017 season is already upon us. You've got 4 games in your back pocket already. We'll talk about those in just a little bit. But I want to talk about this year's team. Let's just preview the team and give everybody out there an opportunity to know what they're going to see when they come to Carl Brooks Field to watch this team play. First, let's talk about the returners. You've got a good core group of returners. Of course, people familiar with names like Janessa Bassett, Shelby Young, Mallory Paulson, they're all coming back. Let's just talk about the returners and what they bring to the table coming back for this season.
Yeah, we have a lot of returners. We have a lot of kids coming back that played a lot of innings last year that pitched some big innings. Obviously, we lose Erin Feichert. She was kind of the heart and soul of the pitching staff last year. But we get everybody else back, you know, and then you throw Casey Jensen in the mix. So our pitching is probably as deep as it's ever been. We're going to rely on a lot of them, you know, all year long. But Brooklyn Beardshear probably eat the majority of our innings early in the year and see how things shake out from there. But we have a lot of kids back that you know, we lose Autumn Woodfall and Christy Johnson were our other two seniors, and so we get everybody else back. So we have a lot of innings back of people with a ton of experience both in the infield and in the outfield.
36-15 last year, 24-8 in the PacWest, good enough for second in the conference. You go to the program's 8th consecutive NCAA regional appearance, your 7th as a coach. What has this group of returners, what were they able to learn from last season and being able to get, you didn't win any games at the regional, but you got there?
Disappointment. You know, a lot of teams in the West feel like, hey, it's going to be an accomplishment to be in the regionals. We don't think it's an accomplishment to be in the regionals because that's kind of been an expectation. We've been fortunate enough to be there every year of the Division II era, so we want to be able to get there in advance. We got spoiled the previous 2 years getting to the College World Series, so we would like to get there and be able to advance. Our conference, especially the top of our conference, is really, really good with Cal Baptist and Concordia and Azusa and us, and then some of the Hawaii schools. So we feel like if we can get out of our conference, we can do damage in the regionals. And last year was disappointing. We pitched it well enough, and we feel fielded it well enough, but we didn't hit it well at all during regionals. So that, going forward, I think they were disappointed that they didn't advance, you know, play better in the regionals and hit better. And hopefully, yeah, that's been a motivation for them.
Leading right into my next question perfectly, you mentioned not hitting it as well as you wanted to. Let's talk about some of the players that you're bringing in. You've also got some of your returners swinging the ball pretty well so far this season, but this year you bring some players in that I know you're excited about that can swing the bat. You've got a Kinsey Sawyer, and you've got a junior college transfer from Western Nebraska, and a whole group of great freshmen, talented freshmen coming in. Talk about your incoming crew this season.
The incoming kids we're really excited about, in addition to a deep lineup coming back. Kinsey hit 50 home runs at Western Nebraska, broke their school record. So she's going to get on track. She's going to have some opportunities with Taylor Godfrey being hurt a little bit in the early part of the year. Kenzie's going to get her opportunities early in the year, and I think every at-bat she gets a little bit better. Riley Tedica, freshman from Viewmont High School, she's a really good hitter. Corey Gaughan, freshman from Phoenix, another very good hitter. Brenna Hink, freshman from Tremonton from Bear River High School, and then Kirsten Quigley, backup shortstop, might not get very many innings with Josie there at short, but all of those kids, you know, Destiny Diaz. Destiny had a great at bat the other night in limited role, but all of those kids are going to have a chance to be really, really good hitters for us. It's probably the deepest incoming class we've ever brought in as far as hitting.
Of course, we can take it a step further and talk about pitching as well. One of those freshmen, Casey Jensen, can also throw the ball a little bit. What does she bring to your already talented group of pitchers?
Casey's a rare kid that I think can survive on three pitches. A lot of kids try to throw, you know, four and five pitches. Casey's going to be, she's a great drop ball pitcher. She's got a great changeup and is learning a rise. And I think she's going to be really, really good with just those three pitches. She's going to be good enough to win some big time games for us by the time she's done. She throws it hard, has good movement, and I think is just getting better and better every day.
Four games into the season so far, you're 4-0. You're fortunate to win all four of those. It took a comeback against Montana State Billings Monday, which was just yesterday, to get the 13-5 win in five innings. What felt like maybe the longest five-inning game I've ever witnessed, but hey, it was a five-inning game. But first, the two wins over Northwest Nazarene on Thursday and then the two on Billings. What have you seen so far that you like from the team?
Well, and both of those teams on paper don't show you tremendous records, but Northwest Nazarene beat Central Washington twice last year. Central advanced out of our regional. They beat Western twice last year. I think they split with every team in their conference, you know, or won games against every team in their conference. So, and they had a lot of kids back. Billings, same thing. You know, Billings was really, really good last year at times. So Megan Detling, the girl that threw game one yesterday against us, beat us last year. You know, so we knew we were going to have to play well. On paper, we stacked up pretty well against them, but you got to go out and play well. We're fortunate that we've been able to be outside. Some of those teams hadn't been outside much before the previous weekend, so we were able to string some victories together, which is good. You know, we have six home runs this year from five different players, so that's a bonus for us because we're getting power up and down the lineup.
And those home runs, as you lead right in, I think you looked at my script here before the interview, as you lead right into my next question, six home runs. Already, that's nearly half of your home run total from all of last season. Yeah. And the home runs in the first four games have been game changers. We're talking grand slams, two-run home runs. I mean, those are the real type of game changers that maybe we're missing a little bit last year.
Big time. Well, Arista hits one in the first inning, and I think Danny had one early against Northwest Nazarene. That changes the complexion of the whole game because then your pitchers are able to throw a little bit more free and easy. They're not in a situation where one mistake beats them. You know, they're in a situation where, you know what, I can attack the strike zone, and if a girl, you know, hits one or they give up a run or something, we still got a little bit of a cushion, so that helps us a bunch.
Up next for your team is the Dixie State Softball Easton Classic at the Canyon Softball Complex. Not every team has an opportunity to do what you guys are getting ready to do, and it's been a lot of hard work behind the scenes, but you're bringing in 14 other teams. This is going to be almost like a national tournament of sorts. You're bringing that many teams in and talented teams at that. First, let's talk about how talented the field of teams is that you're bringing in, then we'll talk about your opponents just in general.
Yeah, we've got some very talented teams. We have 15 teams from six different conferences, you know. So it's you know, from the Midwest all the way over, from Texas all the way over. Very good teams, very good tournament teams, teams that have been to the College World Series, that have been to regionals, that have won their conference, that have done damage, you know, nationally, and have been ranked nationally over the past few years. So we feel like it's going to be a really good test for us. You know, it allows us to see teams from all over. It allows us to see teams that we might possibly match up with in regionals. You know, and then we get to see some of our conference teams that sometimes we don't get a chance to watch until we play them during the year.
Of course, your specific opponents now starting on Thursday with Colorado State Pueblo, then the doubleheader on Friday with St. Edward's UC Colorado Springs, wrapping it up on Saturday with Concordia Portland, not Concordia Irvine, but Concordia Portland, and then Western New Mexico wrapping up your five games in the Classic. Talk about the five teams that you will see. A little bit of an early RMAC preview. You've got Pueblo and UC Colorado Springs on the schedule. You've also got a team in St. Edward's from Texas that you don't get to see often, and then Western New Mexico team that you did play last year as well.
Yeah, and we're going to see a little bit of everything. What I know from those teams is we're going to see all kinds of pitching. We're going to see right-handed pitching, left-handed pitching. We're going to see some teams that are really, really good. They've been sound all the way up and down. Concordia Portland has probably that conference's best hitter. The Lubert kid is really, she's a real deal, with the Orr kid from Northwest Nazarene. Those are probably two of their best hitters in their conference. So we're going to see, you know, tough pitching that's going to throw us some challenges, and we're going to see some really, really good hitters.
Coach, lastly, you play Colorado Mesa, looking even further ahead on the 13th. It's a Monday, meaning, as I count them up, 11 games in St. George. Some of those are more of like neutral site games at the Canyons, not necessarily here at Carl Brooks Field, but you get to play 11 games in St. George, your kids in their own beds, you know, before you have to go out on the road. Is that an advantage to your team to be able to start at home?
We feel it's a huge advantage, and this is one of the reasons that we think it's easy to recruit kids here, is, you know, we get a host our tournament, we get to have teams like Northwest Nazarene and Montana Billings. They know we're not going to give them the return trip, but they're coming down here on their way to a tournament or, you know, to find good weather. So it's a blessing for us that we get to play at home. We have the weather, we have the complex. The city of St. George has been tremendous, helping us host the tournament. So yeah, it's a tremendous blessing. Then we get Adelphi at the end of the month. So we have a ton of home games this month. And the kids really like it, you know, and between the Hawaii trip and fortunately it's over spring break, it really helps us with the Division II focus of being a student athlete, not missing class time. So that helps us a tremendous amount.
Well, Coach, we appreciate you stopping by, taking some time out of your busy schedule. Before we let you go here, it's the tradition. We've got the Trailblazer Weekly hard hat. You'll notice this beautiful set that the folks at CEC built. This represents kind of their hard work that they put into our interview set here, the locker. So we'll just give you this Sharpie and let you sign that there. Pick a spot, write your sport by it. He's head coach Randy Simkins. Again, five games for the softball team this weekend at the Dixie State Easton Softball Classic. It's now time for our next break. When we come back, we'll take a look ahead at the next week in Trailblazer Athletics, and we'll wrap up the show with January's top plays. We'll be right back after this.
I'm Anne. I'm a scientist.
Recycling takes a team.
Why don't you let me
and me
help you out?
Everyone plays a part. Don't trash.
I love taking stuff apart and building new things out of it.
What could be treasure?
Pal's my most advanced Android.
This is awesome.
You haven't seen anything yet.
Give your cardboard box another life. Recycle.
I take the road less traveled, run free, unwind, unravel. Someplace outside with lots to do. Green trees, red rocks, and don't forget that blue sky. The sunshine shining, fun shine, pouring on me. Think I might just stay a while. Say hooray all day because the sun is gonna shine on me. Sun is gonna shine on me. Sun's gonna shine on me.
Welcome back inside Trailblazer Weekly. Another big thanks to softball head coach Randy Simkins, and best of luck to the softball team. It's now time to take a look ahead at the next week in Trailblazer Athletics. We invite you to follow along on your screen as we let you know what events are at home, which are on the road, and I can promise you this is probably one of the most busy weeks of Trailblazer Athletics, that there's going to be lots of opportunities to see your teams at home, and then we'll get you all the results on the road as well. So follow along on your screen. We're going to go sport by sport today. It starts with women's golf. We mentioned it earlier there in that day two of the Point Loma Invitational. We'll have those results for you. That's today. They're wrapping up today, Tuesday, and we'll have those results for you on DixieStateAthletics.com as well as next time on Trailblazer Athletics. That is women's golf. For softball, we talked about it with head coach Randy Simkins. It is a busy few days. It all starts on Thursday, taking on Colorado State Pueblo. They will take on, again, the Thunderwolves at 3 p.m. on Thursday, February 9th. Then on to Friday, again, two games against St. Edwards at 3, and then UC Colorado Springs at 5:30 on Friday. Then to Saturday, two more games, Concordia Portland at 12:30, and right after that, they go against Western New Mexico at 3 p.m. on Saturday the 11th. And then ahead to Monday to Colorado Mesa, a doubleheader with them starting at 2 p.m. The Mavericks, future RMAC foe, will be in town. That game at at Carl Brooks Field. So there's your softball, and hang in there. We've still got a lot more to get to here. Baseball also will have a series, their first home series of the season, starting on Friday, taking on Colorado Mesa. It'll be a doubleheader on the Friday instead of Saturday. That way that doesn't conflict with the California Baptist basketball game later on Saturday. So a doubleheader on Friday, moving to Saturday. Baseball will have one game at noon at Bruce-Hurst Field, and then closing the series on Saturday with the Colorado Mesa Mavericks on Sunday at noon. That's on February 12th. That will close the four-game series against Colorado Mesa for the baseball team. As we continue the busy week, it's women's tennis with their first matches of the spring season. They'll be at Biola on Thursday, and then moving on to Friday, women's tennis at Concordia Irvine, and then moving on to Saturday, the women's tennis team will moving to Sunday, apologize for that, Cal State LA, women's tennis team taking on Cal State LA on Sunday, and that wraps up their week. A busy week for women's tennis. We move on to men's golf as they get their spring season underway. They'll be at the Western New Mexico Invitational starting on Monday the 13th and then going into Tuesday the 14th for the men's golf team there. And then it's women's swimming. They will be in action also. And that runs from tomorrow, Tuesday the 8th through the 9th, 10th, and the 11th. From Tuesday from Wednesday all the way to Saturday, as it's the PCSC Championships, the conference championships for the women's swimming team. And it's all wrapped up with basketball this weekend. California Baptist, nationally ranked on both sides, on the women's side and the men's side. The women's game will tip at 5 p.m., with the men's game tipping at 7:30 p.m. inside the Burns Arena. If there's one basketball game to be to this season, it is this one. If you're watching, if you can hear my voice, you've got to be at the basketball game this Saturday. Again, there's lots going on this week, a lot of opportunities to get out and support Trailblazer Athletics. We look forward to seeing you at those games. Time now to take a look at the top five plays from the month of January. There was a lot of good stuff. We've whittled it down to these top plays. We hope you enjoy them. Here they are. Number five for January, Marcus Bradley. You got used to his offensive stuff, also his defensive stuff, getting a big block there versus Azusa Pacific. That's number five. Moving on to number four, Dixie State women's basketball against Azusa Pacific. Jaden Gonzalez, the steal, evading a defender. And how about a half-court bounce pass down the court to Tremina Jordan, scoring in the lane. Number three, Trevor Hill against Azusa Pacific. Whoop, you think he's lost it. No, he's got it back on his knees, passing back inside of Marcus Bradley for the two-hand jam. Number two, Dixie State women's basketball at Notre Dame Dana Muir early January, trailing 63-61, under 30 seconds to go, no problem. Bentley kicking it out to Jaden Gonzalez, ice in her veins for the game-winning three. And number one, a little more than a week after that shot, the Trailblazers were at Concordia. Trevor Hill breaking ankles, throwing down with one hand for your top play of the month of January. We'll do that every month, starting now from the rest of the season. That'll do it for today's show. Thanks again for watching. Remember, you can catch all episodes of Trailblazer Weekly on demand at SouthernUtahLive.com and on the Dixie State Athletics YouTube page. Enjoy your week. We'll see you next time on Trailblazer Weekly.